lecture will be started in 5 minutes. Thank you for your patience. Good evening, everyone. I'm Casey Shek, the External Secretary from the Law Association, HKUSU. Welcome to the Words to Law Students, Lawyers, and the Public Lecture. The lecture today is the second event of the Reflections on Law Public Lecture series, co-organized by the Law Association, HKUSU, and the Advocacy and Mooting Society, Faculty of Law, the University of Hong Kong. The series seeks to evoke thoughts on different topics in law. The chosen topics are based on timeless evidence, which not only guide aspiring lawyers, but are also of vital importance to the general public as beneficiaries of legal services. This year, we're more than honored to have invited the Honourable Mr. Justice Bokhary, G.B.M, JP, as our public speaker. Following the last public lecture, this reflective journey is continued with Justice Bokhary's insightful words addressed to all of these who pursue a legal career and members of the general public as the beneficiaries of legal services. After the guest sharing session, we will also have a question and answer session. Please feel free to raise any question regarding the topic of today's lecture. After the end of this lecture, we're more than glad to have a mini book sale with the books by Justice Bokhary available at a significant discount. We'll also have a book signing session. Please do not miss this opportunity. Mr. Justice Bokhary has served Hong Kong with notable distinctions as both barrister and judge, culminating in his appointment as one of the founding members of the Hong Kong Court of Final Appeal. Until his retirement as a permanent judge in 2012, he was one of the longest serving members of the CFA. After, he remained on the bench as a non-permanent judge and published a number of books with insightful words. His contribution to Hong Kong's legal system and the rule of law is widely regarded by both the legal profession and the wider community. Without further ado, may we now invite Justice Bokhary on stage to share on the topic words to law students, lawyer, and the general public. Justice Bokhary, please.
Sought and gratefully received help the essence they are, but their nuances are different from one time to another and from one place to another. Time, obviously, many decades have passed since my student days, and place too, for it was in London and not in Hong Kong that I read for the bar. More generally, in regard to place, I have in mind LP Hartley's celebrated line, past as a foreign country, they do things differently. That is probably true, to some extent, everywhere in the world. And as far as Hong Kong is concerned, we were a colony of Britain when I was a student, and for a long time afterwards. Now we are a special administrative region of China. When one speaks to more students, one is speaking to the lawyers whom they will become in future, to the lawyers who were law students in the past, and to the general public, which is served by law. Through us, the law's servants. Indeed, one is, in a sense, a real sense, although a sense not easy to define, speaking to the law itself. It is the law which we serve as individuals, and which in turn protects all of us in community. It seems to me that your thinking, from what I've been told of it, at the dawn of your time in the law, much resembles how I think now in the twilight of mine. Well, you know, they do say this. When you first embark upon Zen, a mountain is only a mountain. As you proceed towards enlightenment, a mountain appears to be many other things besides. Then, when you achieve enlightenment, a mountain is only a mountain after all. The law serves people, corporations, associations. But it is infinitely more than a service industry. It is a profession with a code of ethics. Indeed, it is a calling, one which inspires and instills abiding dedication to it in all those who answer its call. Private practice, whether at the bar or in the solicitor's profession, suits some people. Others may be more at home in the legal academy. Being an in-house lawyer, whether in private practice, private sector or the public sector, is another possibility. options too, and there is room for movement between all these options. Service on the bench is the essential destiny of someone. If you are contemplating being an academic, you might like to know that sometimes, putting it in the words of Professor Noel Coulson, the chair is not only more comfortable, but more influential than the bench. My own career has been of private practice at the junior bar and then inner bar, followed by service on the High Court and the Court of Appeal, and ultimately on the Court of Final Appeal. 5 decades or more that took, but in that time I only managed to move the 15 feet or so between where counsel stand in court and where the judges sit. That cannot be denied, even though a number of my cases, those as junior counsel and later in silk, were before the Judicial Committee of the Privy Council in London, sitting then at its iconic and never to be forgotten venue of number 1 Downing Street. When I went there, I did not go there simply as counsel, I went there almost as a criminal. Anyway, I have made a living in commercial law and a life. Whether in that or in some other way, everyone who pursues a career in law makes a living and a life in the world. I wish you prosperity and fulfillment. Making money in the law is nothing to be ashamed of, unless is one's only purpose. Most lawyers are far, far better motivated than that. Private practice in Hong Kong can be very lucrative. It certainly was so for some of us in my day, and I understand that it is much the same now. Earnings in successful private practice were high then, even though we did a lot of work pro bono. Our successes today also do a lot of pro bono work. Nevertheless, I understand that earnings in successful private practice remain high. But I'm sorry to say it, I feel that I must. Fortune does not seem to be smiling nearly as brightly on your generation as it has smiled on mine. I can say the reason quite briefly. I can't do it in one word, it takes 2 words. Those 2 words are property prices. Of course, they hit wage earners and fee earners, not only in the law, but in all other areas as well. The situation is very difficult, but I bid you not to look upon it as hopeless. Another difference between then and now is this. in the past was not uncommon for students, including law students, to do various jobs during long holidays. I did that, and so did the then law student who later did me the honor of becoming my wife and eventually became a high court judge. As a student, I did manual work, always more cerebral than me, doing the work in offices. We got to know people from walks of life, different from any we had or would otherwise experience. And we returned to our studies in a fresher state of mind than students are likely to be in after work experience in counsel's chambers or solicitor's offices. Yet, when our daughters, all three of whom became successful members of the solicitor profession, reading law, Marina and I, encouraged them, and they accepted our advice, to gain such work experience. Why? Because it built for them, as it will for you, connections that are so useful and almost essential when seeking privilege or a training contract. In the law, as in life, there always are, whether you like it or not, practicalities to be accommodated. On that, I would add this. Practitioners who offer law students work experience should take care not to make it seem either more interesting or less interesting than in real life. Those who provide work experience and those who receive it share a responsibility to maximize its benefits. There may be difficulties ahead, which it's natural to ponder. It is possible that you will experience difficulties in securing privilege or training contract. Progress in your career may not always be rapid. The profession of the law itself may face challenging times. It is understandable to worry about these things. Now, people do not choose to. So it is as pointless as it is insensitive to tell them not to worry. What I can tell you is this. Prepare yourselves as best you can to avoid or overcome all difficulties down the road. And then you will have little, hopefully nothing, worry about. When success has been achieved, you will look back upon the time of struggle. You will remember what it was like to believe in yourself and so many doubted. Striving in the arena, you will come to know, was even better than standing on the podium afterwards. Lovingly, you will remember those who helped you and resolve to help others. receiving love is a great blessing. Having love in your heart is an even greater one. All law must postulate, as Sir Carlton Allen said, a common denominator of just instinct in the community. No matter what sort of legal career you pursue, you will have a role in the administration and development of the law according to the instinct for justice that springs from human nature. It is said in Blackstone's commentary that the law of nature is binding over all the globe at all times. That is echoed in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, and it is re-echoed in Judge Tanaka's famous explanation in the Southwest Africa cases that states cannot create human rights, can only confirm and protect them. For such rights have always existed with human beings independently of and before the state. Let me draw your attention to something from Christopher St. Germain's Doctor and Student. The doctor said to the student, this is a doctor from Doctors Commons, so he's a lawyer too, and the student was actually a common lawyer. The doctor said to the student that the law of nature is written in every human heart, teaching us what is to be done and what is to be fled. And because it is written in the heart, therefore it may not be fled. Nay, it is never changeable by any diversity of place, nay time, and therefore against this law, prescription, statute, nor custom may not prevail. And if any be brought against it, they be not prescriptions, statutes, nor customs, but things void and against justice. Now, legal positivists, whose eyebrows may have gone up, would do well to take note of Lord Radcliffe's natural law. It is a view that he expressed in one of his much admired lectures at Northwestern University. We must never, said, lose touch with the idea of natural law or give up the belief that all positive law bears some relation to it. Professor C.L. Lim, my good friend Chin, perceptively, as he always is, called me in a recent book a natural lawyer by creed. I do not dispute that. Lawyers are passionate about justice. It is a passion we share with the general public. The imperative of justice extends to each and every one of the many and varied facets of life. It is by no means confined to justice as delivered according to what is sometimes called lawyer's law. focus on the courts, the nature of my career should justify my doing so. Otherwise, I hope and trust that it at least mitigates. So Edward Cook, in his first institute, defined court as a place where justice is judicially administered. Access to the courts is guaranteed by Article 35 of our Constitution, basic law. It is an arterial, being the right through which people come to an independent judiciary for the enforcement of all their other rights and the protection of all their freedoms. In advising on cases, preparing them, and conducting them in court, we must keep clean and healthy the artery by which the court is reached. You must never clog it with deleterious material, nor should you ever stand by idly while anybody else attempts to do so. That is being proactively reactive, which may sound like conventional journalism, but it's not. Keeping access to the court in an effective state is the duty of every lawyer at all times. It is a general duty of our calling. So it's not only in respect of cases which land on our desks that this duty arises. One aspect to that is the funding of public interest litigation. There is room for improvement there. I said something about it before. It was said in a recent case. I said that the law on the funding of public interest litigation may in time develop to become more conducive to access to the courts than it is at present. Such development may come by way of legislation, judicial decision, or both. So I said then, and I now add this, that academic writings too are relevant, for they may lend impetus to such development. How must lawyers be trained so as to be produced in what Lord Bowen called the condition desired by the market? That does not mean that your training career will be mundane. It will not be if you devote yourselves to what Sir Anthony Mason called the law's tradition of high scholarship. Conceive in concept to be guided by, like the title Lord Nichols of Birkenhead's memoirs, Let Equity Prevail. It will be a motto and a precept. You must choose your own. Choose it carefully. Do so and you will choose it well. Lawyers are shaped by their interaction one another in ways of which we may not even be aware. We are all a part of each other. mutual respect be the cornerstone of our dealings. The law which we serve, we also will be the better for it. Continuity is important. Some precepts are eternal. But that does not mean stagnation. As Professor Martin Flaherty pointed out, changing law reflects changing times. Indeed, one can go all the way back 300 years and more earlier than Professor Flaherty's statement to Sir Francis Bacon. Essay of innovations. There he said that they that reverence too much old times are but a scorn to the new. We all share an overarching duty to strive, each of us in our own way, to leave the world better than we found it. I esteem it an honor to meet you. Experiences like this are ones which I always welcome. How much? Well, I've said before, and I now repeat, that there's nothing I like better than talking to law students, apart, of course, from spending time with the lecture. My boss always go to the bench. They are prepared to make that sacrifice if they feel that that is the contribution that they can make. Now, to be perfectly honest, I recently said to my good lady wife that I really had more fun at the bar than on the bench. But on the bench, I had a great sense of fulfillment, because at the bar, you try to win the case, sometimes contrary to the moral words. Whereas on the bench, you only try to do what is right. Now, this doesn't mean that people who do not leave the bar for the bench are in some way refusing to make the sacrifice that I and some others have made. Sitting over there is Gladys Lee and Margaret Moon. I would have been honored to have them as my colleagues in the Court of Final Appeal. But they have done work outside of the law, which maybe nobody else would have done. And I don't regret that they didn't go on the bench. We all serve in the way that we feel we can do best. And when your time comes, you ask yourself that question. Do you think that you can serve the world better by continuing?
What does the right, so natural justice. My question stems from my understanding that natural justice is more so a concept of general human dignity, ethics, and morals. However, I also understand that that's something that's subjective. It changes from person to person. So how do you define the idea of natural justice, and do you think courts can effectively convey that into like traditional law?
The idea of natural justice rests in many religious concepts. It is certainly rooted in Islamic law. And as far as Christianity is concerned, Aquinas wrote in Summa Theologica that if law departs from reason, it is not law, but violence. The idea is a whole concept of some fundamental rights in people. It is not the more refined questions that arise, such as whether it is just that I should allow you to have an adjournment, or whether it's more just that I decline your adjournment because the other side should not be kept waiting any longer. It's something wider than that. And human rights is very much rooted in natural justice. In Calvin's case, decided in the 17th century, the Court of King's Bench, Chief Justice Cook dealt with that fearsome thing called outlawry. By outlawry, a man lost his civil rights through a taint. By corruption of blood, he lost the ability to hold property, to transfer it, or to pass it on by descent. By forfeiture, he lost his land. By escheat, he lost his chattels. And what Sir Edward Cook said was that a man who was outlawed is out of his rights under municipal law, but he's not out of his allegiance to the king, nor is he out of the king's protection. For such allegiance and protection were before municipal law and wrestling the law of nature. Now, in what greater extremis would a man be than to suffer attainder, to suffer corruption of blood, to suffer forfeiture, and to suffer mischief? And yet, natural law would come to his assistance. This is the value of it. Now, I might be inclined to name some English judges greater even than Sir Edward Coke. A lot of people have difficulty coming up with such a name. But nobody can come up with a better name among American judges than Chief Justice Marshall. In America, if you say the great Chief Justice, no intelligent person would doubt that you're referring to him. He too spoke of natural law. In Saunders and Ogden, he traced the right to contract and to incur contractual obligations to a source anterior to municipal law. He said that it rested on original principles. And those original principles were, like so many other things within natural law, brought by man to society. So, natural law is about like the oxygen in the air. You won't miss it until it's taken away. Talk to the man who suffers attainder, corruption of blood, forfeiture of his cheat. Still he's bound by his allegiance to the king. Still the king is bound by his duty of protection. That is natural law. And that's why I'm head over heels in love with it.
Thank you, Justice Bokhary, for the sharing. I'm Damien, and I'm a final year law student at this university.
What are you going to do afterwards? You're going to go to the bar?
That's a big question.
Big question, is it? Yes, it is.
You've talked about the past. I assume you meant the past is quite different from now. As you have said, or you have alluded to, actually, there are some negative feelings, or at least at the future of, for example, the profession, at the bar or on the bench. I can't possibly guess what people on the bench are thinking, but I think there's generally a negative outlook on the profession in general. But on the contrary, you in different interviews with newspapers or in your speeches, you have said that, especially you have said, well, even the future is good or bad. Even if it's bad, it's more of a reason to stay. Can I interpret that as at least a glimmer of hope or optimism? And if so, I think as a law student, my question would be, do you have any advice or any tips to maintain that optimism or to maintain a good prospect for the legal profession in Hong Kong?
You might wonder why I make it a habit to walk close to people who are asking questions. Well, first of all, I think it's more polite. And secondly, it puts me within striking distance. is it only asking good ones? You understand? I mean, first of all, you were talking about how judges think, but that's at least a concession that they think. Yes. I think that a lot of the anxiety nowadays springs from the scope for things being done under public law. Now, when I was starting, there was no scope for enforcing human rights the way that we do now, because only requirement throughout the British Empire was that the laws made by the local legislature was for peace, order, and good government. And the Privy Council repeatedly said, in case after case, that this conferred the widest possible legislative power so that you couldn't do just about anything. And we practiced contract tort and criminal law and sent in our fee notes. In recent years, one has seen much more scope for enforcing fundamental rights and freedoms through the courts. And maybe it is in that regard that one anticipates some blowback. But the important thing is this. Times change. And things can move in one direction, they can move in another direction. And meanwhile, there are lots of other things to be done. And one of the reasons why the bar and law society can be influential and their voice is more resonant than their numbers, because even though there are many more solicitors and barristers, there's still not many of them, is because the public thinks, and I think rightly, that by and large, we deliver on lawyers' law. So if somebody comes to you about his lease, about his employment contract, or about the neighbor's flat leaking water into his, somebody's refusal to deliver to him the goods that he bought, or personal injuries that he suffered in an accident, and if you don't deal with that case efficiently, he's not going to be interested in your views of the Constitution and human rights and that sort of stuff. But if you are efficient in those things, then he'll say, look, the man knows his own job. And when he talks about these things, insofar as it is the business of law, we ought to listen to him. So be as efficient as you can in everything you do. In the field of public law, do whatever you can. Look forward to a greater day, a brighter day. And meanwhile, preserve the good reputation of the law by being efficient in whatever it's called upon to do, accidents, contracts, lease, whatever. So that is a lot to do. I have confidence. But my staying here, perhaps, is not such a great sign of confidence, because I say I would stay here no matter what. I'll die here. I'll be buried here. And that's one of the reasons why I am happy. prominent lawyers younger than myself, like Gladys and Margaret and so on and so forth, are here today. And my good lady wife, Rina, who's also very young, supporting me because even after this old man is gone, there will be generations of lawyers. To support. Well done. Having referred to my wife's youth, I suppose I better make a confession that I myself am not as good a husband as I ought to be, because she deserves better than the broken promise that she received from me. Many years ago, I said that we would grow old together. Well, we're still together. And as you can see, I've grown old, but as you can also see, she is as young and beautiful as the day we met. That's the advantage of youth. Anyway, there are a lot of people to support you. I support you when I, as long as I can. After I'm gone, I support you in spirit. And others will continue. I wish you well in your career.
You have mentioned in your lecture that as a judge you will interview what you believe in as well. But my question is, what is right for him? So I'm sure that you have an example, Scalia. And I think you two will probably have very differing opinions on what is right or what is not. So do you think that as a judge you should opt to interpret law with, that reflects the current public morals, or that Justice Scalia believes you should reflect what the founding fathers desired at the time of the creation of that particular piece of legislation, or in the US case their constitution?
Well, young nephew of mine, you've answered your own question. You said, what is right, Uncle Kenny? Yes, well, Uncle Kenny is right. But the truth is this, that when I had that dialogue with Neo, I did say that it is quite possible that in actual cases, coming to the result from different directions, we would arrive at the same result. Not often, but maybe not as seldom as people think. And they look back to those times. And I rather think that he looks back too far. But as far as we're concerned, how far do we look back anyway? Our constitution came into existence in 1997. We all know what the situation was. So there's not so much problem about original intent. And therefore, we are not troubled by the idea that something, although it doesn't strike us as just today, is nevertheless warranted under the Constitution, indeed mandated under the Constitution, because of the thinking at the time. Well, I must say that in the Dred Scott case in 1857, the United States Supreme Court, by a majority of this way, held that people of African descent were constitutionally precluded from American citizenship, and that slave owners, even better, slave owners had a constitutionally protected right of property in their slaves. Well, quite honestly, I mean, a majority of the United States Supreme Court took that view about their constitution. Now, I don't think they were right even at that time. Supposing they were, certainly wouldn't be right now. So I think that have to do justice according to law, not according to whim, but according to law. And I'm not so sure that what is actually just is all that difficult to decide. The greater question is whether the law permits intervention to achieve justice in that particular way. Because there are some claims which are morally just but may not represent the law. But when it comes to fundamentals, certainly human rights and natural law, the natural home of it is customary international law. And it's difficult to think of any greater name in the field of customary international law than Sir Herschel Oshpak. And he said that the moral claims today often become the legal rights of tomorrow. So by the time you begin to look at all as decrepit as I do, I hope that the law will be in a better state than it is now. And if it's not, then it's your fault.
Thank you, Mr. Bokhary. I know that you quoted Teddy Roosevelt in the famous, very famous arena quote. In essence, is it your view that in bad times, precisely we need even more lawyers, and to quit is not an option? My second question is, institutions, including the legal system, have their own intrinsic limitations. For judges, for instance, you have to give effect sometimes to bad laws. I mean, how do you approach these kind of moments as you make this abstract move in pursuit of justice?
To tell you the truth, Alvin, I didn't even know that Teddy Roosevelt had said that. I admire him to a certain extent, but he's not my favorite Roosevelt. In fact, even Franklin Delano Roosevelt is not my favorite Roosevelt. My favorite Roosevelt is Eleanor Roosevelt, the inspiration behind the Universal Declaration. But the truth of the matter is that the supply of lawyers, touch upon that, is something which is problematic. Because if you have a whole lot of lawyers, some of them cannot get work. And as somebody once said, there's always room at the top. In a union you have 10,000 lawyers, people still queue up and try and go to the best one. The important thing is that nobody should leave the law for any reason of lack of confidence in it. And as far as achieving justice is concerned, what is going on this evening is perhaps an illustration of that. Some of you have asked questions about how these things can be achieved, and the answer which you give might be slightly different from mine, slightly different from yours or his or anybody else's. But we're all interested in delivering justice, are we not? And that's the first thing. And if that's what we mean to do, then most of the time we will be successful. Now, lawyers come and go, but the one thing I would not like to see is any lawyer leaving the law for lack of confidence in our present situation. A, because I'm not sure that we need to be so lacking in confidence, and B, you know, when I say that the worse it is, the more I stick it out and come home. You know, recently, good officers, I had something to say on behalf of Stan News, and strangely enough, a lot of people seem to think well of it and think I'm a splendid chap for saying all these things that I say, thinking all these things that I think. Well, what it shows is that I am loyal to Hong Kong. But how much credit am I entitled to receive for that when there are so many people who have received far, far, far less for Hong Kong than I have, who are no less loyal to this place than I am? But, you know, if people say something nice about you, you don't want to quarrel too much with it, but occasionally honesty drives you to make an admission such as the one I just made.
Thank you very much for the inspiring sharing. As a law student, I aspire to enter the legal field in the future, and I want to know what you think is important and how should law students to maintain or maintain our competitive edge under the under society with uncertainty and rapid changes, like for example like technological advancements or political and economic changes. Thank you very much.
Technology is concerned, very young people like you and very old people like me have no difficulty. You being very young are totally on top of it, I'm sure, even if you're too modest to admit it. And I, having grandchildren, rely on them to teach me. The world changes. The world changes, and we change with it. We must keep up with the innovations, and in devising the courses for the PCLL, which I'm heavily engaged in for another university, we are seeking to introduce training in relation to technology. But you know, the trouble with PCLL subjects is that almost any time anybody mentions the subjects and says, is this worth teaching? Of course the answer is yes, but they're only 24 hours a day, or maybe 25. And how much time can people spend on all of this? So there are challenges in that area. There are challenges in public views on what the law should be doing. And I don't think that any given time lawyers will not be met with some people who regard them as taking too liberal an outlook, and some people who accuse the legal profession as institutionally conservative. We have to do the best we can. We are all individuals. We don't necessarily all see things alike. But if we all devote ourselves as lawyers to saying that the law must serve people, and most of the time how the law serves people is not going to depend all that much on whether you're liberal or conservative. I mean, all of my dissents have tended to be, not entirely, in the human rights field. In other areas, one tends to agree more as to what is just or unjust, what is practical or not practical. And sometimes there's really no answer to it. I mean, supposing one says the period of limitation is 6 years. Well, why should it be 6 years? Should it be 5 or 7? It's an arbitrary thing. Then you take something like time of the essence in completing a contract. Well, the market in Hong Kong is a very fast-moving market, and therefore people must know their position. Are they bound by this contract or are they not? But sometimes people say, well, look here, you know, if a man is a few seconds late because the clerk, conveyancing clerk, was delayed because he stopped in the street to help an old lady who fell over, why shouldn't you relieve it in equity? And the High Court of Australia said in the jury in Haiti that you ought to, and the Privy Council said in the Golden Eagle that you shouldn't. Well, the answer is that the longer you've been in the law, the more cynical you become. And the truth is that, yes, if you could be absolutely sure that that's exactly what happened, then perhaps you should intervene. But if you do not say it has to be strict as far as completion is concerned, strict as to time, there'll be all sorts of arguments about whether justified, and while that argument is going on, all the way to the Court of Final Appeal perhaps, nobody knows what to do with this property. And the market is moving. So if I don't know whether I am free of the contract, and you don't know whether you can hold me to it, we're both in an awkward position. So a lot of it has to deal with practicalities. And you don't always feel that it is perfect justice. There isn't, you know, because if there's perfect justice, then we'd be living in utopia. And if we're living in utopia, we wouldn't need a court anyway. We wouldn't need a law. But if you want to do the right thing, then most of the time, if you're an intelligent person, you will. And as a law student, you concentrate on passing your exams. And looking to your future. And in doing these kind of things, if you are properly taught, and I'm sure you are, Mr. Justice, you will become a fit and proper person to participate in the administration of justice, whether as a barrister, as a solicitor, as an in-house lawyer, as a legal academic, and I was being perhaps as a judge. You will be all right. Just do the best you can everything that you're doing right now, because it's all part of the process by which you develop. I have great faith in you. Sorry I wouldn't be around to see it when you achieve all these great things. But don't feel sorry for me and say, well, I've achieved all these great things and the old man's not here to see it. So I don't need to see it. I already know it. I can recognize you by the sense of your question. That you will go far. Maybe as a barrister became a judge, I would quite like it if you went to the bar and went ultimately to the bench, but there are many other areas which you can sort of do. They're all right by me.
Thank you, Justice Bokhary, for your amazing and very enlightening speech about the law. And thank you. I'm a first-year law student, and I was wondering how, from the perspective of a judge who's had so much experience, how would you say that judges should balance the doctrine of stare decisis, like continuity, with the changes
in society that happen as like time goes on? From your perspective, how do you think judges should balance these two, as you, I think I recall you described yourself as quite a liberal judge? Thank you. Well, Professor Lawson said in his handling lecture that all lawyers in the same moment value continuity. court in making sure that nobody is disadvantaged by a development of law. And I think that how a contract is interpreted is something which you have to be careful about changing, unless you're prepared to do it by way of prospective legislation, which is itself adjudication. It is difficult, because you might have entered into transactions on the strength of a decision. Now, when it comes to the law of torts, I think that you can be more innovative, because nobody says that I look at this judgment of the Court of Final Appeal, and therefore I think I can safely cross the road now. Nobody does that. They don't cross the road on the strength of your judgment, and therefore what you do in an accident case can vary. Sometimes one says, well, should one develop the law judicially, or should one allow it to happen by way of legislation? Well, sometimes the legislature will not do it. In the famous case of Baker and Carr on legislative reapportionment, President Kennedy said, well, I'm very glad the courts did it, because if you leave it to the legislature, they'll never do it. Sometimes the legislature will do it, and aided by the Law Commission, the Law Reform Commission, will do quite well. And perhaps the cases in which one is better to lead to legislation is where it is necessary to devise a rule, a number of exceptions to the rule, and so on and so forth. And you can't expect the court to deal with all of that in adjudicating one case. So as far as stare decisis is concerned, the common law system would not exist without the doctrine of precedent, couldn't exist in any of such thing, the end of the common law. On the other hand, too rigid an adherence to precedent would also be the end of the common law, because the common law is organic. So because it's based on precedent, it needs stare decisis. Because it is a developing organic institution, it depends on stare decisis not being applied to rigidly. And it depends. I mean, you know, some people know more law than others. I mean, when it comes to the Court of Final Appeal, if you want to know how to address the Court of Final Appeal, very simple. There are five of us there. Between us, we probably have 250 years' experience in the law. And we're not totally stupid, you know. And if you convince us that what you're saying is just, we will find a way of letting you win as a matter of law. And if we think that what you're asking for is unjust, we will find a way of making you lose in law. So, precedent is quite flexible. I talked about 250 years' experience. Of course, I took 5 months. 250 years' experience. Law getting different people have different ways of being precedent. Have fun. Yes.
Well, Justice Bokhary, thank you for sharing. I was hoping to ask, to what extent is it possible for a judge or a legal professional to remain impartial and not be affected by their personal experiences while carrying out their duties? Thank you.
Well, you know, if you are affected subconsciously, then you won't even know it. But it is remarkable how impartial you become when you assume the seat of justice. There are some people who are not nice to people. There are some judges who are rude, some who are polite. By the way, there's no such thing as a rude judge. You're just a rude man or woman who happens to be a judge. Just like there's no such thing as a rude tax affected by her own personal position, because if that was so, it would be very difficult for any consumer claim to be defeated. Supposing somebody says that he's not liable on his credit card because he lost it, he notified, and the credit card comes to say, no, he's inadequately notified. Well, as far as the judge is concerned, he probably has a credit card to his own. And unless he happens to be a very upset judge, he probably doesn't belong to a family which owns a bank or credit card company. So why don't you always decide in favor of the consumer, just in case one day his own credit card gets lost? We don't do it that way. You know, we don't. You just don't think along those lines, really don't. And I've never known a judge who does. But if you are subconsciously affected by your experiences, well then, what can you do about it? It's subconsciously. But hopefully not. And that's one of the reasons why listening to arguments is very important. Because that can reach even the subconscious thinking. So the subconscious may affect your initial reaction. If you listen to the argument, you might say, well, look, they are intellectual arguments. Consciously and subconsciously biased in favor of all of you. I won't be talked out of it.
In light of the time limit, we're now accepting the last question from the floor. So please feel free to raise.
Thank you so much for your sharing tonight and for giving us insights about various perspectives of the legal field. But I would like to take a step back as law student, because not all students chose to study law because they want to pursue a career in the law. So what are the things that we should have in mind or we must consider when we make our decision on whether we should enter the legal field? Thank you.
I can't tell you who, unless it will help you identify the son if I did. Said that her son was applying to university to read microbiology. But at the last minute, he decided to switch to apply for law instead, because he didn't want to stand there waiting for a computer to spew out some results and find that board. So she said to him, I suppose now you're going to write your personal statement that it has been your ambition ever since you were a small child to become a lawyer. And he said, yes, that's exactly what I've been saying. Now, the point is this. As far as the law is concerned, if you are very lucky, you will be attracted to it. And particularly if you are attracted to the bar. Why? Because then you can do the same thing all your life. I went to the bar because I was interested in court work, and I'm still doing court work today. But there's no earthly reason why one should want to, but if you do, you're lucky. But most people find it difficult to decide, so the only thing that we said about the law is this. You've got to qualify in something. And as far as the law is concerned, it's a good training of the mind. It's a good training of the mind. And it doesn't mean to say that you have to practice law or even take a job in the legal field. More than 60% of the presidents of the United States were legally qualified, and some of them are very prominent in legal practice. Abraham Lincoln was a superb advocate and lawyer. And of course, Taft, after he became president, became Chief Justice. So if you are in a little bit of doubt as to whether you go to the law, then you go to the law unless you can think of something you like better. Because otherwise you've got to do something. And the good thing about the law is that you can be quite flexible. And you don't always have to stay in the field in which you qualify. My youngest daughter's husband, clever as a barrel of monkeys, and he took a first in physics in Cambridge, and now he's a banker. If you have a good mind, and in fact, if you went to some large corporation, unless you went to the legal departments of that sort, if you have a very good degree, whether it's in philosophy, history, mathematics, law, they'll say, this person has got a good mind. We can train them in the ways of Coca-Cola or Wells Fargo or whatever it is. So there it is. You know, go to the law unless you can think of something better. And don't think that you've made a mistake, because you haven't. You can always go into another field if the law ultimately doesn't hold attraction for you. Although I hope that it will.
To extend our appreciation, may we now invite the chairman of the Law Association, HKUSU, Mr. Amanda Huan, to present a souvenir as a token of appreciation to Mr. Justice Bokhary.
Somebody gives you something, you hold it up like this over your head. Because if you do that, people will think that you deserve it.
And that's the end of today's public lecture. We once again express our gratitude to our visitors for Perry for his insightful sharing. Of the day, and good night, and best wishes to you.